Cottonmouth Kings don't stand for the gang. Cottonmouth Kings just let the nuts hang.
Yeah, dude, so I guess that's kind of where I wanted to start. I know you've been part of the, you know, the KMK crew for, like, as long as it's been around, pretty much, right? I mean, it's been a long time.
They got started in, like, 96. I hopped in with them around 2000.
Okay.
So I've been in, like, 2000 era.
Yeah, so can you just maybe just give us a rundown on how all that happened, how you met up with the dudes?
Yeah, well, to be honest, like, I was into, like, ICP and some crazy-ass underground shit at the time, and this was, like, 97, 98, and they already make some noise. I hadn't heard anything yet, but my homeboy Gillies, Nashville, from Burl Street, a.k.a. Verdano Beach, the fucking soil, shout-out to Gillies, we ditched school one day to go smoke some bud, and he's like, yo, you gotta listen to this tape. These dudes are talking about ICP. And he presses play to this one part, and he's like, the CD was on, and the radio was on, and the CD was bumping. And
so
he comes talking about Chicken Hunt, and I was like, oh, shit. And I was like, he's like, dude, these dudes live down the street from me. And, like, we kind of did a little drive-by, and we seen them. And they had, like, an old-ass Cadillac, and they're just hanging out front. But we didn't say shit. We're like, oh, fuck, that was those dudes. And the pictures of the album, like, that's crazy. And then I kind of, like, ended up graduating from school. And then I got into some trouble, so I had to, like, leave town. My parents moved out of the whole area, and when I was gone, I seen a fucking video. I always wanted to rap, right? So to make a long story short, I seen a video with Eminem, and I was like, that motherfucker's white? Oh, shit, and he's with Dre? Oh, that's a rap, dude. That dude's gonna kill it. And then the next video that came on was Bump by Cottonmouth Kings, and I was like, they came on, and I started to recognize them. I was like, wait a minute, that's that. This is shit Gilly showed me. These dudes are like a mob. Like, I'm going to try to get down. I'm going to get down with these dudes. So I ended up just blasting Cottonmouth on my stomach before I met any of them. I talked my homeboy into doing it. I was like, this dude's my cousin, man. I was, like, lying to him. Like, these fools are like, I'm related to these dudes. He's like, I'm not going to blast a band's thing on your stomach like you're crazy. I was like, no, this is family. Before I even met the dudes. So, like,
oh, wow.
I was, like, a crazy fan. But I ended up, they slid a picture to Bobby B or something like that. And, he was like, yo, we don't need any more friends, but invite this dude over. And the day I went over there, D-Loc was there, and I became friends with him. And he kind of, he was getting out of a relationship or some shit at the time. So he was, like, looking for a road dog. And I just happened to become his road dog and sleep on his couch, sleep on his floor, take me to clubs in Hollywood, Pacalica when I was, like, 21. And then I got to go on tour with him. And he threw me out a song, threw me the microphone, and pretty much, like, D-Loc's the reason why I started getting heavy into them. He'd bring me on tour with them, and she kind of snowballed from there, became an artist.
Yeah, man. Yeah, that's awesome, because, like, you know, I'm jamming those old albums and stuff. Those dudes were all about throwing shout-outs and having with their whole crew, so you hear your name all the time. And then when you finally got, you know, like you said, you got the mic, it was pretty cool, you know. And then from then on, it's like I've always kept up with what you're doing, you know, so that's badass, dude.
Yeah, it's a trip, because when I first tour I was going to go on, I was supposed to be in, like, a promotional van with these dudes called the Hit Squad. We were just going to go city to city the day before the show, so we wouldn't even see the shows and just flyer the town up and then hit the next town. So, like, the day before, these kids would know that Cottonmouth are coming into tour, and then that they're coming into town to do a show. When I got to, like, the parking spot where the bus was and the van and shit, that the van was packed to the gills and only two of them could fit. But luckily I was friends with Pac and friends with Loke and knew the guys from going to the shows locally, that they were like, yo, Chuck, just hop on the bus. 2-3 days, that van will be, like, empty almost, so we'll make some room for you in there later. But for now, just, you're coming. Hop on the bus. And, like, within an hour of me being on the bus, they're like, you know what? You're staying on the bus. You're going to be on the BLL, back lounge loadie, roadie. That taught me how to, like, undo, like, speakers. I learned how to do Lou Dog's bicycle.
Oh, nice.
I learned how to do Bobby B's DJ kit, and I was, like, a roadie for them, so I'd help load speakers in and help load out and, like, help them open beers and fucking keep their weed lit while they're on stage, and kids would jump on stage. I'd give them, like, 10, 15 minutes of freedom and then, like, let them know, like, yo, you gotta jump off, like, keep it moving. And it was a fun job for sure. And then one night, I think it was the first night, he had a part in a song where he called me out and he just threw me the microphone, and then from there, they do that a lot, and I just started grabbing the mic, and then it snowballed in like Subway Soldiers and all kinds of shit. So I was put myself in a good spot with some good dudes at the time, you know?
Yeah, man, that's badass. Yeah, I was always curious on how that went down. So skipping like a lifetime, I guess. Now y'all are doing the King Click. The new track had dropped at the time of recording just last night. And it's getting quite the response, man. That's pretty cool. Can you maybe tell us how this kind of happened, this whole King Click group and who's involved and whatnot?
You know what? It's crazy that we're using the name King Click, because King Click has been around, like I said, from the beginning. It was like all the homies and everyone like that came with the band, and like the Judge D's, the Grand Vanacks, yeah, the fucking, you know, the D-Gaffs, and bringing Saint back on and doing all kinds of stuff. Like, they were going to have a King Click t-shirts and King Click songs, and then they were going to do an album before, and it didn't work out. And then another time, they were going to do one with me, Saint, and Cottonmouth, and call it the King Click, but that didn't work out. So me and Saint ended up working together and doing the D-Gaff record. And then I kind of was like thinking to myself, why don't these dudes want to work with Saint? They don't want to work with Saint. What's going on? And like, I was really naive, and blind loyalty led me down a hallway of where I would just do whatever the fuck I was told, you know, pretty much like a blind loyalty. Caught my kings. Okay, this is what it is. Stay in line, this and that. And to be honest, like, dudes started hating. And the dude that put me on, Dustin Miller, a.k.a. D-Lo, he's the one who's like would tell us like, yo, Saint Dog, he told me to pretty much do the album with him, but when it came out, he didn't want to jump on the record. He didn't want to get us to get shows. He didn't try to help us, you know, when we went on tours and stuff, and we were supposed to do all kinds of shit. But I think there was still some resentment with Saint. I don't know what the deal was, but we did play one show at the Grove in Anaheim, and the response of the fans was so gnarly that people told me, like, yo, they think you guys are going to take a little bit of piece of the pie, so you guys are on your own, pretty much. When it came to booking shows and stuff for DGAF with Saint Dog, it was like MySpace and the people that were around me helping out, and like, we didn't get management, we didn't get the love, because I guess we were a threat to other people's cheddar, and we were just trying to make some noise, you know, and being put on. But that's what happened with that. And then Saint was crazy, you know. Saint's crazy. He was a crazy individual, and I seen a lot of stuff touring with him too. It was fucking amazing times, but it made me become like a solo artist. So I just started, when I came back from a couple tours, I was like, all right, I'm just gonna do this on my own now. I can't really rely on anyone but yourself. So that's when I kind of started doing my own thing, and the Subnoise fell apart. The whole relationship kind of thing fell apart, and then the Subnoise and Cottonmouth Kings battled, and once again, blind loyalty led me to down the road just roll with the Kings, because that's who brought me in, and I really didn't ask questions about what happened. And then once I found out the real truth and what was going on behind the scenes and what happened in the lawsuit and all that dirty shit, I was like, oh fuck, there's some questions to be asked with Mr. Brad X for sure. He's quite the character, Mr. Johnny Bravo.
Yeah.
But yeah, when it comes to like paperwork, I don't do that kind of stuff, and he threw my name in there a little bit and almost got me jammed up for like using my voice on a phone call or something like that, with what I had to do with the lawsuit shit. With my people don't play that stuff, so it's not in our DNA. So when you cross that boundary, it's like I no wonder he's silent. No one knows where he's at. And that's not a threat at all. It's just, it is what it is.
Yeah. Wow, man.
God bless it. I hope I'm the best.
Yeah. And so I guess, damn, that's kind of what led up to this group now, I'd imagine.
And then Dustin also like going about Cottonmouth Kings on his own, and then trying to do it by himself is kind of like okay, damn, that's crazy. Because, and he's telling people like, they're not making songs, and yeah, Richter's not gonna make a song that's a trashy song. He values the music. It's not about the money and just putting something out there to get a quick dollar. He wants to put quality music out there, and Richter's not really vocal online. He's more of an in-person kind of person, which I value that from him. And I'm glad that we got our relationship where we're at right now. So Richter is going to be like the backbone of this shit. That's why we're going to call it the King Click. So Richter's the backbone.
Yeah.
I come in, help out. You know, I've been around for a long time. I got my credit. And then we got Obnoxious. the new blood, who's I've been known about Obnoxious since like 06, fucking freestyling on 106 and Park, Freestyle Friday battle rapping. You know, I've been a fan of his. So like when I moved to San Diego, I got in touch with him, and I actually got him on my Henchlord record, and then Zinger heard him on a DJ Muggs Soul Assassins radio or something, and he was asking me about him too. You know, this guy Obnoxious, like, he's the fucking shit. Yeah, I got him on my record, and next you know, he was the next dude signed to The Noise. So it was like, we all need to come together somehow. We were going to do Some of Our Soldiers, but like back in the day, like Some of Our Soldiers was like everybody, you know, and some people thought the name was kind of corny and stuff like that. So we tossed around like King Click, and everyone agreed, and we're like, yo, this could help kind of save this legacy that's being tarnished right now, and due to bad decisions and bad business and just greediness, to be honest. So let's bring it back to what it really is, and that's the fucking foundation of the music and the live shows and different characters and that mob mentality of just like gutter skate punk rappers from the beach area. Or so, you know, it's crazy. So we got Het P.E. on there, and I think Het P.E. had that song for a while, and he wanted to get everyone on it, and he's like, Jared's down to do all the stuff, so he's part of the King Click for sure. And we got Mad Child part of it. I've been in the talks with Judge D, Big B, you know, getting some of those dudes are involved. So like the album is not even fully made yet. We got some songs made, but between my connections and Richter's connections and Obnoxious connections, the people that we can get on this record is going to be ridiculous. So the King Click is not just us, but like we are the foundation. Me, Obnoxious, and Richter right now are the foundation of the King Click. But we're going to be bringing in all kinds of homies that are familiar faces and dope voices, and so, you know, and use our connects as people that have a good reputation in this business still, and aren't here to fucking screw people over. And through my years of touring, and I've always been nice to the fans, and I've tried to be upfront and personal and cool with everybody, so that's kind of gotten me to where I'm at. And I've seen that with those dudes in the beginning, with Loke was super nice to everyone, and then all of a sudden it's like they're Elvis Presley or something that's too cool for school, and it's like that's not how it works, you know, not on this underground. You gotta be personal with these people.
Yeah, man.
You know, we're not selling out the Fillmore no more. They're not, it's not the hype, the hype is really gone. These younger kids are on to other bands.
Yeah.
So like we gotta hold on to the fan base we have and be lucky which new ones we get. So it's a rough road, but hey man, I'm fucking with it.
Yeah, and, man.
That's, the response has been good.
Yeah, for sure. You know, I wanted to touch a little bit more on the KMK album in a sec, but I just got to say, dude, being like a fan of this stuff and being in it for so long, just knowing about it, I'm not like by any means a hardcore fan or anything, but I do look forward to everything that happens, and I try to keep up with it, obviously, with the YouTube channel and stuff. What everyone wanted, including myself, is a group, you know what I mean? To just stop being lied to, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It all seems so fake whenever it was all built on something that was very real to a lot of people. And it's just what y'all guys are doing, just it's so badass. I just wanted you to know that. This is what everyone wants. This is it.
Yeah, I've been watching your channel for a minute, and I was wondering, I wonder where this dude gets his information from. Is he just a fan? Because this shit is great. I was watching, I was like, oh, he knows a lot of stuff. Like, maybe I should pop in these comments or say something.
Yeah, man, I really appreciate that, dude. That's awesome.
It's DGAF for life, bitch, and that's it.
That seems to be the big conflicting thing with Brad, is some people say he did his best, he did what he could, he got screwed over and all this and that, and then I hear the other side of it too, you know. Can you maybe elaborate on that a little bit more with me?
Well, I'll tell you what. As far as Loke being really mad at Brad, what Brad did was, you know, he sold the catalog, obviously. Uh-huh. Loke talked about it. So he sold the catalog to Clay Patry and took the money and ran. But what he actually did was he took the money and paid off all the lawyers and all the rights and all the stuff, so Cottonmouth can do what it's doing today still.
Yeah.
So in a way, like, he's helping D-Loke create the monster that he's become. So to me, my beef with Brad is about, you know, putting my name in a deposition, which I'm not supposed to be a part of. I asked him not to. So it's on a whole other level. But, like, yeah, he was the brains behind a lot of that shit and the core foundation of Cottonmouth Kings, and, like, the he was a maniac, like Johnny Bravo. Like, he's very smart, and he was like a nowadays a Jake Paul. He would be like a Jake Paul or something nowadays if he was growing up.
Yeah,
so like
yeah.
He knows how to stir up that controversy, like with this whole thing. First time I really noticed that he was a mastermind for publicity is when he had a cyst removed from his neck. And then he told everyone that he got stabbed. And I seen online that he got stabbed. And to me, like, I'm Cottonmouth Army, so I back in the day, and I would try to fuck people up that had beef with Cottonmouth. Like, I was, like, there to help them out, and I had street credibility and some people that would help me fuck people up. So we would we had Cottonmouth's back, and at the time, I was like, how the fuck did this one get stabbed? Like, that makes us look weak. And I was like, didn't he just have surgery? So I put it all together, and then, like, he called TMZ and made up a story that he got stabbed, but I, like, ended up backfiring on him a little bit, I think, because it was like people found out, like, yo, you had surgery, like, what the fuck, that who stabbed you, like, how did you guys are, what the fuck?
Yeah,
and it wasn't a good look. And that's when I knew, like, that guy was kind of off his rocker.
No shit. Yeah, I remember hearing something about that. That's crazy. So as far as the new album, again, the King Click album, I know you said you're gonna get a lot of different people on it and things like that. Is there any chance that there's, like, some Lost Saint verses out there that haven't been heard that can that will pop up on this?
Well, I can tell you one thing. Saint Dog's son is going to pop up on it.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that, too. I saw him floating around in the pictures.
Yes. He's laid a couple songs for Saint Dog's record that they have they're putting together, because there are some Saint Dog verses laying around, but I think they're going to save it for his record.
Okay.
So, but I heard some of it, and I was like, who's that? And they're like, that's me. I was like, that's you? And it was Max, which is his son, and, like, he's got it, dude.
Wow.
And it's just, yeah, it's crazy to see, so yeah, I think he's going to jump on a few tracks with us as well.
Hell yeah, dude, that's awesome. That's really cool to see. It's yeah. Like you said, it's nice to see the legacy, you know, y'all guys are trying to preserve it as much as possible. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's fucking rough.
So speaking on the legacy again, I mean, I assume you've heard the new KMK album?
No, I did. Hell yeah, I put an ear to it for sure. I did put an ear to it.
Yeah.
I had to.
Yeah. What did you think of all that?
You know, if he would have called it D-Lok's tribute to the Cottonmouth Kings 25 Years of Life album or something like that, if he would have, I see what he's doing. Like, I know he's put a lot of energy and I know what it takes to build a record, and he's doing it all by himself. I give him credit, but, like, I think it sounded really rushed and unprofessionally recorded, and just, like, the overall sound, like, it was hard to listen to every song. I couldn't, like, my ears were hurting, and I listened to some fucked up music, so to me, I was like, damn, this is bad, like, this is crazy, like, and then him talking about, like, online, I see stuff online, and people hit me up, they're like, yo, this, what is he talking about? I remember how Pot got kicked out, and I remember these days, and even Haas called me, like, yo, this fool is talking about making money now that my brother's dead, he can blow up Cottonmouth with Richter, and Richter doesn't want to do songs, what the fuck is that? People are on my neck, and I'm like, talk to him. I don't know, dude. That dude's on a sick one.
Yeah.
So I just, like, just to know, like, the backstory, and then to see him online saying, like, me, this is mine, and then on the record, it's us, we, you know, like,
yeah.
The music, like, I'm like, wait a minute, dude, come on, bro, you can't fool us all. It's kind of fucked up in a way.
Yeah, totally. It's,
He did want Pac out of the band, because Pac was taking money and Dirtbo was coming in the band, and Pac didn't want to take cut. He was like, okay, then we just don't have a dancer. He was like, him and Brad were the last two people to make the decision. And yeah. So he's online saying, like, no, I had nothing to do with Pac getting kicked out. That was a fucking lie.
Yeah.
And it was crazy to me to see, like, when Pac died too, that they didn't go to the tribute. They didn't go to his fucking they didn't show up to the shows to raise money for the funeral like Richter did.
Yeah.
I did. Saint did.
Wow.
Loke and Brad, nope, they weren't there.
No shit.
Yeah. And then to see him, like, paint Pagalika's name in his house, and, like, all of a sudden now he's dead. He was like, oh, rest in peace, Pagalika, we love you. I was like, well, you didn't love when he was here. And then when like, Saint Dog died too, I sat back, was like, what was the last time I really talked with Saint? He was congratulating me on the song that I did dissing D-Loke, Smith & Wesson Reloaded, because he had gotten a hold of me when he was in prison, three-way, was like, yo, dude, this fool Loke, I haven't even got a record yet. I haven't even got a copy of the record. He didn't give me no money. I don't know what the fuck's going on. If he got fucked up with the other guy, King or whatever it was, fucking,
Oh, yeah, Kingmaker or whatever.
Yeah, King, whatever, like, Saint Dog, no matter what, Saint Dog was still owed some money, you know, and he didn't even shout him out or another, try to give him no help. And then when he got out, it was like, just the Saint Dog guy had some shit to do, and he fucking went and did it, man. It sucks, but I really don't even know how he died, but I'm hearing it was an overdose. I never really wanted to know, but I was just like sad, you know. And then to see like Loke again, like he wasn't really happy with Loke one time of his death. So it was hard for me to sit back and just see that kind of shit. It's crazy, man. But yeah. He always wanted to, but I do remember saying like, I'm gonna be down with everyone for the fans. Like it I don't want to. I want to be down with everyone. I'll be down with Big B. I'll be down with D-Lo. I'll be down with Chucky. I'll be down with everybody. And I was like, "Damn, you're fucking so smart, dude. You're right. We gotta unite."
Yeah.
Instead of fight, but it is what it is at this point.
Yeah, yeah, man. Yeah, that's pretty nuts. Do you know what Richter's thoughts might be on the new KMK album?
That's why probably he didn't jump on the stuff, because he wants quality music. So the stuff that Loke was sending him was probably fucking hot garbage. And Richter's been hook master, fucking extraordinaire for the Cottonmouth Kings for decades.
Yeah.
And wrote a lot of the records and come up with a lot of the melodies and set a lot of the tone for the stuff for Loke to just come along and hop on. Like, Loke was never really the guy known for writing. He was the face and the charismatic character on stage and the good looking dude that the chicks wanted to fuck. And the homies wanted to be homies with, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
he was the face of it. And Judge D, dude, this could be on the record or off the record, I don't give a fuck, but Judge D, dude, wrote a lot of his stuff in the early years. Saint Dog wrote a lot of mostly all of his stuff.
Of D-Lo?
Yeah. Oh, and wow. That Kingdom Come record, I think that dude Corleone, I heard he wrote 94% of the record. Wow. And then never got a dollar from it. And Loke was supposed to split profits with them with the beats and all this stuff, and at the end when it came out, he's like, you know what, you guys aren't gonna get anything. And they're like, what the fuck, I just did all that work for you, made you the record, wrote your rhymes, and you're gonna shit on me? Fuck you.
Yeah.
So, and then I don't know about this record, but I guess he's got some other people helping him write. But yeah, dude, he's always been having people write for him, so he's never been like that guy.
Yeah, no shit. Yeah, and it's crazy, dude, after all this hype, you know, the album didn't get uploaded on Apple Music until like 7 o'clock or something like that, and the KMK album, and you know, no one's gotten their pre-orders, and the quality just isn't there. You know, obviously, whoever they got to produce it didn't know really what they were doing, in my opinion. So
it's sounds like it was recorded in a trash can.
Yeah, dude. So I mean, it is such a relief to see the key click and to hear that track. And I mean, I don't want to, I try to stay positive with everything, but Richter's verse on that seemed pretty telling too, you know.
Fuck yeah.
So
fuck yeah, dude.
The bigger man, I caught off the trigger, man. Came up with a bigger plan. You can't fuck with Richter, man. It's like the wise say. Sometimes you gotta turn the page. Gotta cut the grass to reveal the snakes. You gotta leave the past where it fucking lays. And once the casket drop in a self-dug grave.
But you know, the more that comes to light, it's just like, shit's not cool, man. It's not cool. And it's just so great.
Wait till the new podcast that we're gonna have come out. We're gonna do another podcast and we're going to have everyone come through. I'm going to have Judge D come through for a couple hours, and he'll fucking put it on blast, because that dude's been silent, but he was there from the beginning, too, and seen it all go down and knows it all.
And this is going to be another one of those live streams that y'all do?
Yeah, well, I don't know about a live stream, but like a podcast that, like, kind of like a Joe Rogan. I had like 4 or 5 episodes of the DGAP podcast, but when COVID hit, the people that were helping me set up the cameras and do all the audio,
okay,
they got over scared of the COVID thing, so... Now we got some new people, and it's kind of clearing up, so we're going to restart the DGAP podcast and
get back going
again and talk some shit, you know?
Dude, yeah, I can't wait for that. I've been trying to reach out to Judge D. That guy's hard to get a hold of, man. A lot of the old school crew, I always have trouble getting a response, so I really appreciate you talking to me, man.
Yeah, fuck yeah.
And we're looking forward to the rest of it. Thank you so much for being a part of this, and if you can maybe let Richter know and everyone else that y'all guys are on the right path, this is what we want, man.
I appreciate you, man, and I'll be staying tuned. Keep it real. I'll talk to you soon.